Thank you very much, Minister Schramböck, Minister Fassmann, Director Gelling, dear ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure being here with you today on probably one of the most important and most decisive topics that we are dealing with. I was asked to provide my view on future skills, the right mix, if you like, and what you see here on this title page already, these are not just model pictures. These are current and most likely future employees here working at our sites in Villach, in Graz, in Linz, in Klagenfurt, and in Vienna. I'm going to give you this kind of insight, broader view from, let's say, practical life, and I will take a broader view on exactly the topics that are relevant to us, as I think. And more specifically, I want to cover those four elements, our work environment, and in particular, I will address not avoidable, the digital transformation, give you some insights, but also some facts and developments, and how they contribute to our changing work environment. Some developments, some comments on the developments on the labor market, what it means for skills and qualifications, this kind of right mix, and the contributions of companies. We already play a significant role, and I will conclude with some comments and recommendations. Our work environment. Many of you know this picture. This was taken in 2005 during the announcement of the new Pope at that time, Benedict at that time. And you see here the audience, and if you look at the following picture, 2013, this was referring to the current Pope, and this is already one of the indications. Yeah, many people with their smartphones, and you can see that here on the picture. So you might know that this has become a reality with regard to digitalization. I also want to add here a different picture. That's this one. And again, this is not just a model arranged picture. This picture has been taken 2017 at the Infineon site in Malaysia, talking about the impact of digitalization. And I do not want to make a gender-related comment at this point. I rather want to make or age-related comment, you could also draw from this, but I would rather relate to this aspect of the huge impact digitalization has. And this very much relates to education, being able to deal with modern tools, having access to a totally different form of education. And therefore, I think digitalization and education are closely linked in the sense that they open huge opportunities and shape realities as we typically don't think about. But this is taking place right now. Now, who are we, Infineon? We are a globally active corporation. We cover three basic areas: energy efficiency, mobility, and security. These are our business segments. Last year, we had a revenue of roughly 7 billion at corporate level. We work with a network of roughly 40,000 employees worldwide, and you see the spread here. And in our area, microelectronics, you are either very much leading in global markets or you're not really playing a role. We are in our three target markets: energy efficiency, here represented by power electronics, energy efficiency applications. We are a global market leader. In security, we are also global market leader. And in mobility, automotive, we are number two at global level. Infineon Austria, you see the figures here. We have a revenue, we had a revenue of 2.5 roughly billion euros last year. We constantly do significant investments. Last year, 150 million. We work with employees, roughly 4,000, the dimension of 4,000, and we are very research intense. Last year, 17% of our revenue invested on R&D. I could put it differently. We have some 10% of the global corporate employees, and nowadays we have almost 25% of the global R&D staff. So we are very much research and innovation oriented. We have started some roughly 50 years ago in Austria, at that time as cheap production site. Nowadays, we are one of the most research-intense companies in Austria. And quite recently, 5 or 6 weeks ago, we announced that we are doing a strategic investment in Infineon. The Infineon Corporation is going to invest 1.6 billion to build a new microelectronics production site in Austria, in Villach, in addition to some 860 new R&D staff we are looking for. And together with our investment, 1.6 billion, we are a company that deals with digitalization. We create additional jobs, some plus 400 additional jobs. Now, this is a conference dealing with education. So guess what? What was the key reason for the corporation to decide for this biggest investment, not only in Austria for the last decades in this area, but also in Europe, in our industry? This is the biggest investment. So one of the key reasons was the experience, the know-how, the education of our staff. And it's both as perfectly well fitting also the title of my presentation. It's the qualifications, the know-how, plus the mindset, making things happen, being able to look around your typical work areas. Many of those aspects that are nowadays typically called transversal skills. And of course, additional framework conditions also play a role and have been playing a role. But the key competences, qualifications of employees, our current and hopefully our future employees, this has been a decisive factor. Now, why are we important in this context of digitalization and education? Microelectronics is the key technology linking the real and the digital world. This is done by microelectronics, microchips. And it has a significant economic impact. Look at those trends that you see here, those major trends and the applications, smart mobility, for instance, an automated and autonomously driving car, industry 4.0, digitalization in manufacturing, the intelligent infrastructure. It is estimated by 2020, this will contribute to roughly 50% of the European GDP. 2020, that's tomorrow. And this is what's currently taking place. And microelectronics is here in the center. So what I'm trying to say to you is, this is a key enabling technology. Without microelectronics, we will not take part in digitalization. And in economic terms, it's significant, particularly for us in Europe. Why is it so important for us in Europe? Because for the first time since a long period, in the course of digitalization, the core element is qualification. it's not that much anymore about, say, cheap labor. It's not about the cheapest hands, it's about the smartest brains. And therefore, education is so extremely important. If we want to take advantage and shape the opportunities digitalization offers. Now, global challenges, global societal challenges and trends, if you like, they are closely interlinked with digitalization. And many of you have seen most of them regularly. What I'm trying to say here is, with digitalization, with the smart usage of electricity, if you like, we can generate more output with less input. Like, for instance, energy efficiency. We are able to generate more power out of the resources, and in particular, renewable resources. Or mobility, think of the electrification of the car, or the autonomous or automated driving. This provides more flexibility, more mobility, sustainable mobility with less resources. Or in communication, for instance, digitalization offers more opportunities to higher flexibility, connectivity. And all of you, you have been part of it already since this one. And who remembers? This has been how long ago? 2007. The iPhone came on the market in 2007. Just a little bit more than 10 years ago. Imagine how much it has changed our way of living. So, the other thing on digitalization is speed. Time and speed. And what you see here is the 50 million users, let's say, milestone. It took some roughly 75 years by using the phone and then increased. And with nowadays the various computer games and so, speed has become significantly important for digitalization. It's a characteristic of digitalization. When you find something on the web, it takes sometimes just a couple of hours being able to reach millions of people. And this is the hugest challenge, I think, for the educational system, because education, by definition, takes much longer, while at the same time, digitalization is so important, it has such a high dependence on education. So time has become a significant factor. And the second message I want to highlight here, the biggest changes yet to come. What you see here is a number of sectors, industry and economic sectors, plus the degree of change. In gray, you see the estimated change that has taken place already. In red color, the still open expected change. And you see the highest rate in media, already pretty high here. But then look at education. Education gray is here. So even when this study was done back in 2014, even at that time, people expected a huge change potential in education and in many other sectors. And it's up to us to shape this change and to create the change opportunities. And what's for sure, the slow movers will take the disadvantages. Again, we have to be fast in going ahead and creating those opportunities. Now, the final example I want to give you on the speed of change, again on electronics and microelectronics. Many of you remember this guy, Steve Jobs, iPhone, Bill Gates, also one of the heroes, and Gordon Moore. Why was Gordon Moore important? Because he invented, let's better say, he formulated, he postulated a statement basically saying the number of elements, transistors, doubles every almost 18 months. This is not a scientific law. This was basically built on observation, but it proved to be right. So don't worry, I won't go into the details here, but based on this law, Moore's law, we saw significant changes. Think of, again, your phone at that time, nowadays your smartphone. Nowadays, it's much less costly. It changed in terms of behavior, for instance. If you charge it, it doesn't get that warm, hopefully, anymore, as it used in the past. It's much smaller, for instance. And this, most of this is due to Moore's law. And what I want to say to you is, in our industry, in this industry of electronics, we saw a significant, you could even say, revolution, making many of the devices many of you are using quite frequently smaller, cheaper, and much more efficient. So if you would calculate and compare that to the automotive industry and to the aircraft industry, converting this change that took place over the last 30 years, guess what? A Rolls-Royce would cost, let's be generous, $3. Yeah? And would use 1 gallon to go for 3 miles. This is the change that took place. And that we accept that we use almost daily and quite frequently. And most likely, quite some of you might have a small 767. Maybe the garage would be a bit difficult. Yeah? Because it would cost some $500 and would be able to circle the globe within 20 minutes on five gallons. This is the huge technological change that took place. And now think of the educational system. Think of all the engineers, all the experts that were behind that. And this change will continue, and most likely with exponential speed. For us, in industry, the fourth industrial revolution, we are heading towards a intelligent, connected, more flexible everything. And this is what we also find here in our industry environment. Now, this is the environment we observe, we experience, and we shape. Now, talking about the labor market, many of these things are known. The so-called millennials have different expectations. I tend to say it's not just the millennials, also us. But by tendency, you find more people who want to experience more autonomy, who want to and expect a more innovative environment, an environment that can accommodate the creativity. And of course, it changes the jobs to a bigger extent. Now, our future work vision, on the one hand, it's based on this deep knowledge and know-how that change is not going to end, but it will continue. And our view is that we want to drive change. We do not want to be driven. It deals with the courage and the trust to manage and deal with the digital transformation, and we want to support our people. It's all about the potential of our staff and of the people that are around in the work environment. So putting all that together, in linking the trends, the business demands, and work, let's say work 4.0, one could say the megatrends driving the business demands, the future work, and characterize what I would call work 4.0. So changes like liquid organization, so less hierarchy, for instance, flexible organizational ways of working together, mobile working, remote operations, or for instance, leadership challenges, remote leadership, working in intercultural, locally distributed teams. This requires a very different way of leadership and of interaction. Human-machine interfaces, for instance, and what's called here ambidexterity, that even the facts are not that clear anymore. You observe developments and you can interpret it this way or the other. Has this been the case before? Yes, of course. Has it increased? Yes, indeed. And this is the challenge. So amongst all the facts, how can you guide your way? How can you provide the leadership? And how can you create organizations and the interaction of all the people working there? And that brings me to the key competences. Here, I would say you don't find too many surprises. But in the life of a company that works in such a dramatically changing environment, that deals with this kind of speed I have described to you, this gets a different dimension. Of course, technological competences are still relevant. And here, and it has been mentioned, and we have been mentioning that for many years, we see a significant lack of technological, most likely not talents, but educated people. And this is particularly sad because this technological competence provides career and personal opportunities. Digitalization competences, for instance, or being able to deal with data has become a key competence. And then, of course, supplemented by specialized competences, and then, in particular, personal competences and social competences. So we have been telling ourselves all these elements for many years. But now they are really becoming decisive. And then if you look at the skills, this is a ranking and listing of one of the references of the World Economic Forum. And again, many of those quite mentioned frequently, complex problem solving. I would even say being able to deal with complexity. How do you find your way amongst these complex environments and organizations? Critical thinking, yes, of course. Everything that deals with people, and people typically not being placed at the same location. But I would even go further. I would even like to say, in our societies, typically in Europe, we are very much driven by fear. Many people fear to lose. So how can we convey this kind of optimism, this kind of joyful desire to shape our future? And I think what's extremely important amongst these, let's say, top skills is providing experiences, positive experiences of managing challenging situation. Not being successful and finding a way out of it. Bewältigungsstrategien, I would say in German. Being able to deal with not being successful and providing the guidance of getting successful and as such strengthening exactly this capability. And I think this would be an important element in addition. Now, companies play a significant role, in particular in education and qualification. If you keep in mind what I told you about our industry, this rapid change, these huge developments, you can guess that companies like mine and many others had to do a lot. If I want to be provocative, I would even say there is kind of a parallel educational system that has developed. Not because I underestimate the effort in the educational system, but because the need is so huge and speed is so dramatic. So what have we been doing nowadays amongst our almost 4,000 employees? Despite the fact that we are a company at the forefront, in the center of digitalization, we have as many employees as never before. We have the highest number of employees, and we create employees almost every day. We have changed the qualification significantly. Within the last roughly 15 years, the degree of our staff with academic degree has almost doubled. And we have in Austria manufacturing plus research and development plus global business responsibility. So also within manufacturing. We are a highly international company. Some 25% of our staff is from almost 60 different countries. We would like to see more women. So far we have some 17%. And vocational education and training plays a significant role. Training and education at all levels, but vocational training on the job plays a significant role. How are we doing that? We follow the formula of 70-20-10. We have recognized, I should say, that people, humans, we learn best according to this formula. 70% in doing things, in practical experience, through real-life jobs. 20% through the interaction with others, and 10% in a way that most of us have experienced in formats of formal learning. So we follow this formula in most of our educational programs in the company. And our portfolio is pretty broad. And as you can see here, the formal training listed here, rather small sector, and all kinds of 70 plus 20% training methods listed here. Company-wide, social learning, on-demand learning, and career-based. And I won't go into the details here, but this is a huge spectrum that represents the huge training needs and educational activities we have developed. And also MOOCs, of course, within the last, say, 3/4 of a year, we have been quite active on MOOCs, tailor-made MOOCs, that are very positively received. The changes have also impacts on our employer, let's say, activities, and I shorten that basically from posting an opening to being more active in networking and selling the job opportunities. So I end with some conclusions and recommendations. I think it's pretty obvious, and this has been the case for many decades here by Abraham Lincoln. In this case, the best way to predict the future is to shape it. Yes, that's very true. So digitalization is one of the key opportunities, in particular for Europe. I mentioned that. Education is the key enabler. And vocational education plays a significant role, is deeply integrated. And in particular, during times where we have such a lack of technically trained people. Education is key on the one hand, but I also think education, as huge as the task is, I think we have to think of ways of education that can better reflect the time requirements, the speed requirements. And one of the issues we have explored is coming up with experiments. We have set up a small kindergarten for 130 people, kids, with an entirely different concept, both in didactics as well as in content. Focus on natural sciences and technology, for instance. Trying to implement and having implemented a very different also pedagogical concept. And I think this is also what we need in our society, experimenting more and giving test cases, exploring opportunities and trying to capture the speed requirements. And again, putting it a bit more bluntly, I think digitalization challenges us with respect to the speed, the individualization, and the flexibility. And that was perfectly well represented on the Slido snapshots here. I would also like to add the fun. We have not been talking about fun today. I hope you're going to do so during the conference, because what I want to highlight here, education and learning and development very much has to do with the joy and fun of development. And I think if we are not able to convey that, we will not reach new dimensions and horizons in creating this kind of enthusiasm for science and technology, bringing more in a broader group of people interested in science and technology. We need a growth mindset, learning as kind of path to your self-created successful future. And companies contribute a lot. Companies have set up out of the need of the lack, in particular, as concerns science and technology, a huge spectrum of educational activities, in particular vocational education and training, and at least more exchange and further stimulated change would be useful. With this, I conclude and look forward to the discussion and wish you a successful conference. Thank you very much.